Hi everyone, my name is Karah Charette and I'm a pelvic floor physical therapist at Pelvic Health and Rehabilitation Center. I work at the Berkeley and San Francisco clinics. And today with this Pelvic Pain Explained webinar series, I'd like to go over Pelvic Floor 101, asking ourselves, what is the pelvic floor? What is the anatomy, the physiology, and how can physical therapy help? And this is in honor of May being the Pelvic Pain Awareness Month as we start to spread more education and communicate more about this topic. So with this picture here, one of the most important things we need to do is first look at the muscles of our pelvis. Most people have never seen a picture or don't know that there are muscles in this area of our body. I like this picture because it shows that there are many muscles that exist here and that these muscles live at the base of our pelvis and form what we call the pelvic bowl. When we look at this picture, on the left, you're going to see a picture of the female pelvic floor, and on the right, you'll see a picture of the male pelvic floor. I like this picture because you can see a lot of differences, but also a lot of similarities between these muscles. I think it's also important to acknowledge that men have a pelvic floor as well, which is something that is less talked about. And then we have to ask ourselves, what is the function of these muscles? So these muscles play a really big role in supporting the contents of our abdomen, as well as supporting the organs in our pelvic bowl, which include the rectum, the bladder, and for women, the uterus. They also help to control the sphincters, or the holes, that help to control urine and bowel function. We also need to appreciate that these muscles play a big role in sexual function and pleasure. And lastly, these muscles help to stabilize our pelvic girdle and our trunk and help to manage pressure within the abdomen. We also need to consider the surrounding muscles. Muscles such as the abdomen, the inner thighs, our glutes, and even some muscles in the low back play a really big role in helping the pelvic floor muscles be healthy and function to the best of their ability. So then we have to ask ourselves, what exactly is pelvic floor dysfunction? Dysfunction in the pelvic floor is when something's going on with the muscles in that area, when they're not at their healthiest length-tension relationship. And this can lead to a variety of symptoms. The first thing we want to take a look at is urinary dysfunction. So this can be any increase in urgency or frequency, any pain or burning during urination, any hesitancy to start a stream, double voiding where you have to go multiple times to feel like you've released all of your urine, waking up in the middle of the night multiple times to go to the bathroom, and any form of leakage or involuntary leakage of urine. Bowel dysfunction is another big signal of pelvic floor dysfunction. We see a lot of constipation in this culture. Sometimes people have pain during or after bowel movements. There can also be leakage of bowel movements and just rectal or anal pain. And these can all signify that something's going on with the pelvic floor muscles. Another big topic that we could definitely talk more about is sexual dysfunction. Anyone who's struggling with erectile dysfunction, decreased sensation, decreased ability to orgasm, or any pain with sex at all, could be suffering from some form of pelvic dysfunction, and we definitely need to start talking about this more. And as you can see with this slide, the list can go on and on. There are a lot of sources of pelvic pain, and this is why we have to, again, start to get this more widely talked about in the medical community and get our doctors as well as our physical therapists evaluating these patients to make sure we're getting a correct diagnosis. So what causes pelvic pain? It's really multifactorial. There's never just one thing that's going to cause this. As physical therapists, we're of course going to consider the musculoskeletal system. A lot of times the muscles themselves can cause a lot of pain. But we also have to consider how the nervous system can play a role in this. A lot of times hormones can play a big role in this type of pain. And we also have to consider things like the GI system and the viscera, or the contents of the abdomen, as issues in these areas can often cross over into the pelvic floor. Pelvic floor PT, what exactly is it? So as physical therapists, we're still going to look at the body through the musculoskeletal lens. The big difference with what we do is that we have a specialty to assess the pelvic floor muscles. So I'm going to go over what an examination would look like, how we assess these muscles, and how we would then treat these muscles of the pelvic floor. So when you go to your first appointment, you're going to have to start with an examination. Your pelvic floor physical therapist is first going to ask you to just tell your story. And this is where we can learn a lot about what's going on just by hearing your story. We're going to then ask a lot of questions regarding your bowel function, bladder, sexual function, and of course, follow up with any pain. And then we want to know more about any history with surgeries, medication, pregnancies, childbirth, and any prior treatment you might have had. All of these can really help to explain what's going on. And we will definitely ask you what your goals are, as we want to work with you to achieve those goals. We always start with an external exam. So we want to start by assessing your posture, the pelvic alignment. We're going to check how your core can stabilize. And then we're also going to look for things like trigger points, any connective tissue dysfunction. We also want to make sure we're looking at the vulva to check the color for the health of that tissue. We're going to look at the mobility of tissue around the clitoris and around the external area of the vulva. We always want to check sensation for any pain or decreased sensation in that area. One of the biggest things that pelvic floor therapists really focus on are what we call myofascial trigger points. And these are areas in the body where the muscle is contracted and doesn't want to release. And these can play a big role in terms of pelvic floor dysfunction. So we'll always be looking for these on that first initial exam. So with pelvic floor dysfunction, it's been shown in a lot of research that trigger points are very common and play a big role with this dysfunction. And this is important to acknowledge because we get a lot of people who will stretch and do breathing techniques and other things that they think are going to help this area, and it can certainly help. But if those trigger points have not been released and addressed, a lot of times patients will plateau. Another big thing that often goes overlooked is connective tissue. And this is also called fascia. And fascia wraps around our muscles in our body, and it plays a big role in being able to get blood flow and health to the tissues, the surrounding tissues. And if there are any type of restriction in this connective tissue, it can play a big role in creating pain and dysfunction in those muscles. So as pelvic floor physical therapists, we spend a lot of time assessing this connective tissue, and we're not just going to look at the pelvic floor. The connective tissue in your lower extremities, your abdomen, your low back, and the bony pelvis area can all play a role in dysfunction of pelvic floor muscles. So again, we're going to look at the body through a holistic lens and try to look at all of those surrounding areas. In pelvic floor PT, we often do a technique called skin rolling, which you can see in this video here. And skin rolling is a technique that allows us to lift up the tissue and roll through it in order to see if we meet any resistance or any areas of pain, and that tells us that there are restrictions in this tissue. I think it's important to acknowledge that as pelvic floor physical therapists, we're always striving to be supported by research, and the techniques that we do are supported by research and are evidence-based. So this is a study that describes that when we evaluate patients with chronic pelvic pain, a very common finding for the majority of these patients is that we are finding abnormal tone and tenderness. We're finding asymmetry, and we're finding things like trigger points and connective tissue restrictions. Again, another study that examined and found the same thing, that a lot of defining characteristics of pelvic floor dysfunction include connective tissue and myofascial abnormalities. Another big piece of what we do as pelvic floor physical therapists is an internal exam. And this is, of course, with your consent as a patient. But this is a very important aspect of what we can offer, because with this internal exam, we can get a better idea of what exactly is going on with these muscles and what we can do to help treat them. With this internal exam, it's always with one gloved finger. We're not using any type of equipment. And it's done either through the vagina or through the rectum. And with this exam, what we're trying to do is palpate the muscles to figure out if they're too tight, if they're too weak, and if there are any trigger points or connective tissue restrictions. We're also going to assess coordination and see what the strength and endurance of these muscles are, as well as their ability to relax. So again, we're always looking for a multitude of impairments. We want to try to find those trigger points. We want to define your pelvic floor as being hypertonic or too tight, or hypotonic or too weak. We're going to look for those connective tissue restrictions. we're also really going to take into account if your nervous system has been heightened from this pain, because we can work with that as well. And we also want to look at your body as a whole and how you're moving your body and if there are any biomechanical dysfunctions. And then we'll make our assessment. We're going to combine the history as well as our physical findings to try to determine the mechanism of injury and what we can do to treat that. We're always going to consider any previous treatments you might have had and how they were effective or not. And we want to make sure that we're communicating with other providers. Something that I think is great about physical therapy is that we want to collaborate with all sorts of providers. That includes your doctor, that could be a nutritionist or a psychologist. We're always trying to look at this through a holistic lens and treat you from many perspectives. And we always want to work with you as the patient. It's very important that we work together to set goals that are realistic, attainable, and what you want out of your treatment. And then when it comes to our techniques for treatment, it's going to be a variety of things. I think one of the most powerful things we can offer as pelvic floor physical therapists is education. At the end of the day, we want to educate you and empower you to feel more in control with your body. There's a lot of stuff that you can be doing independently and at home once we teach you how to do it. Beyond that, in the clinic, our manual skills are going to help a lot as well. So things like that connective tissue manipulation, releasing your trigger points, we can even mobilize nerves, trying to calm that nervous system. And then we're really going to work on strengthening if it's indicated, or teaching you to relax if that's indicated. We can also use extra things like biofeedback, electrical stim, and of course we're going to give you those home exercises and teach you lifestyle modifications so that you have things to work on at home. When it comes to the physical therapy plan of care, a lot of times with pelvic floor PT, it's usually that you're going to be working with your therapist for 1 to 2 hours a week for about 8 to 12 weeks. And the reason for this is it takes about 8 to 12 weeks to see any change in a muscle. So we want to make sure that we're doing this consecutively in order to see the most change. After that time, you may find that you might decrease your frequency to every other week to a point where you can eventually become independent. And with this plan of care, we're going to try to get you to modify some things in your lifestyle, and a lot of these changes could very well be temporary. We're going to try to get you to do a home exercise program, as doing this stuff at home at a higher frequency is going to allow you to do better for longer. And of course, we want to coordinate with an interdisciplinary team, as people always get better when we look at things through that holistic lens. So you might be asking yourselves, what can you start doing today? One of the best things you could start to do is pay attention to how you're pooping. And we're going to talk about how you could poop a little bit better. So one of the biggest things is that, unfortunately, our toilets have been designed in this culture to kind of set us up for failure. Our pelvic floor really does need to be in a more relaxed and squatting position in order to eliminate bowels more easily. And the reason for this is because of a muscle in our pelvic floor. So you can see in this picture, there is one muscle that actually hooks around our rectum. And when we're sitting, I'll go back to this previous slide, when we're sitting like the picture on the left, we're not actually allowing that sling to be released. When you look at the picture on the right, this person has their feet up on a stool, which allows their knees to be above their hips. That allows for the picture on the right here, for that rectum to become less kinked and for the bowel movement to happen more easily. So there's a really awesome product called a squatty potty that you can order that will actually get your feet up and your knees above your hips. But you can also just use a stool at home or like a garbage can and try to just place your feet on that and see if that helps. And if it does, this is something you want to start to do every day when you're having your bowel movements. We also always want to be communicating with the general community out here. So on Instagram is a great way to connect with us. And Alana from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania asked, where does one start with getting treatment for pelvic pain? Which is a great question. Where do you start? So one of the first things you can do is really try to advocate for yourself by asking your healthcare provider to refer you to a pelvic pain specialist. If they don't know of any in the area, there are a lot of resources online, including the International Pelvic Pain Society. You can go to pelvicpain.org. And you can also go to pelvicrehab.com, and they can help you locate pelvic floor PTs in your area. And this is a growing area of healthcare, so hopefully you will find more and more pelvic PTs popping up wherever you live. fun thing to mention is that we are doing a giveaway of the book Pelvic Pain Explained. This is a great book to understand your symptoms more if you want to do a little more reading on it. So if you go to our website at pelvicpainrehab.com and you fill out the form to join our newsletter, you'll also be enrolled to potentially win a copy of this book. And of course, with this time, especially during COVID, but in general, telehealth has been really popping up. So right now, Pelvic Health and Rehabilitation Center is offering virtual appointments for anyone seeking care. And this can be a great opportunity to even just ask, is pelvic PT right for me? We can educate and teach you a lot of things online, even if we can't do hands-on techniques. And it also is worth mentioning that we're offering integrative health and nutrition services because, again, as we talked about earlier, the GI system is really connected to the pelvis. So if you're noticing you have any issues there, we have some mentoring with that now. And we also have some mentoring for people who are pelvic floor PTs and want to just learn more. And that's a great opportunity to further deepen your knowledge. So in conclusion, thank you so much for watching this seminar. I hope that you learned a little bit more about your pelvic floor. And if you want to stay connected and continue to learn more, you can follow our blog, which covers a lot of topics on our website. You can join our Facebook group, and you can also follow us on Instagram and Twitter at Pelvic Health. And we do a lot of great overview of continuing the education in this area. And if you want to see me remotely, if you go to our website, you will see my information at the Berkeley and San Francisco clinics. And we also have locations other places in California, as well as on the East Coast. So if you have any interest in coming to our clinic, please go to our website to learn more. Thank you again for tuning in and listening, and hopefully you'll check out some of our other seminars. Thank you so much.